So now let's take a look at the idea of simple linear regression. Simple linear regression is called simple because it only involves one predictor variable, such as maybe the number of hours studied, that's your predictor variable, to predict a course score, a grade that you're going to get in a class. Linear regression is actually a technique that we use to fit a linear model to. Or we want to actually model data that has a linear trend. And this model is actually an equation of a line that fits the data. And this process that we use is actually referred to as least squares regression. It's a least squares regression. Least squares is actually a mathematical process that actually comes up with the equation of the line. Now, we're going to rely on technology to actually figure out what the equation of the line is, but I do want you to understand a little bit what's going on here. So let's just suppose that we have data. I'm just going to pick like three data points. Now, if I wanted to fit a line through this, if I were to give this to you, to everybody in the class and say, fit a line through it, you're all going to do something maybe similar to this. It may vary a little bit, you know, come up and down a little bit, maybe change the slope a little bit. So that brings us to the idea of how do we figure out actually the best line. Well, what least squares does is it takes this known value of y, and it takes a value on the line, and it measures this distance. So because the actual value of y is bigger than the line, this would be a positive value. Well, the same thing would be done here. Measure this distance, that would be a negative value. This distance would be a negative value. And I'm going to call these EIs. So like E1, error 1, E2, error 2, E3, error 3. What least squares does is it takes the sum of all the EIs and forces it to be 0. So in other words, as I move this line, if I adjust this line, this error is going to get either bigger or smaller. And there should be some balancing point where the positive and the negatives will actually balance out. Now, if you think of it, that is actually an average. Isn't that what an average does? Won't an average be a balancing point? If I take every data value, subtract from it the average, and I add up all those differences, won't it be 0? That's exactly what this is. This is like an average. So least squares regression finds the equation of this line that balances out these positive and negative errors to make sure that they're 0. Now the equation for the population regression line is y equals beta naught plus beta 1x. Well, let's just go back to algebra a second. You're used to the idea of y equals mx plus b. You've seen that like crazy back in algebra classes. Exact same idea here. Only we switched the order. This beta 1 is the slope of the regression line, where m is the slope of the line back in algebra, and beta 0 is the y-intercept, where b was the y-intercept back in algebra using this form. And the reason we changed the order is because this is simple linear regression, but we also have regression that looks perhaps like this. Oops, let me see here, I slipped. I need the beta 1 here. Then say x1 plus beta 2, x2. So now I'm introducing new variables. So I can keep introducing variables and start adding more betas, beta 0, beta 1, beta 2, beta 3. We're not going to do that in this class. But that's the reason that in statistics we change the order. We don't follow necessarily that order that we're used to seeing in algebra. Now we use betas to represent the population parameters. So this is the population parameter for the y-intercept. This is the population parameter for the slope of the regression line. For sample regression, we use y hat. We put that little hat over it that indicates it's a sample regression line. It's an estimated value of y. And we use the lowercase b0 and b1 for the y-intercept and the slope of the regression line. Now, to do regression, there's a couple assumptions we need to take a look at. First of all, the major assumption is the data follows a bivariate normal distribution. Well, to actually confirm something is truly bivariate normal distribution is a little bit difficult to do. But we satisfy it reasonably by a scatter plot. Oops. Scatter plot of the raw data. And if we see something that looks like it's a linear trend, then this assumption is typically felt to be reasonable. The error terms, the epsilons, is a random variable that is distributed normally with a mean of zero and a constant variance. Now, remember I said earlier when I did this graph, come back up here, I said these are E's, the error terms. Well, this is from sample data. If it's a population data, if you did the population, then we're going to use epsilon to represent the error terms. So E's estimate the epsilons, just like X bar estimates mu, R estimates rho, and so forth, etc. Now, what this is saying is that we need our epsilons to be distributed normal with a mean of zero and a constant variance. I don't know if the variances don't really care what it is, but just it needs to be constant. Now, the constant variance assumption is actually more important if you're doing prediction intervals than it is for just simply a regression line and to talk about the significance of the slope of the regression line. But if you're going to do prediction intervals, a confidence interval for predicted value, then this constant variance is extremely important. Now, we satisfy these by number one, do a normal plot. Of the sample errors. And the sample errors are referred to as residuals. That will tell me if the errors are reasonably normal. The mean of zero is guaranteed. That has to happen because of the least squares regression. The mean will always be zero. So there's really nothing to check there. That is a mathematical guarantee. Now, the constant variance and this next assumption that any two values of epsilons are independent of each other, both of these are satisfied by a scatter plot where on the x-axis, I'm going to put down whatever I'm using to predict with. Whatever I use from a original scatter plot, that x value, and then the y value are going to be my residuals. And this is very commonly referred to as a residual plot. Now, I'm looking for a couple of things here. Because the mean is zero, it's guaranteed by the least squares regression, what I'm hoping to see is basically a blob with no discernible pattern. That would be good. That means they're independent, and this blob, the variability refers to variance in this direction. It's reasonably constant. You're never going to find it perfectly constant. It's just never going to happen, but it's just, is it reasonable or not? What we don't want to see on a residual plot is perhaps residual graphs that look like this. This is a huge problem. See this curvature? What this means, I have a bunch of negative residuals followed by a bunch of positive residuals followed by a bunch of negative residuals. That's a bad thing. This is one way of actually telling us that what we did is we actually fitted a straight line to curved data. This would violate the independence because where I am tells me where I'm going, and that's a bad thing. Another thing that we don't want to see in reference to constant variance is we don't want to see patterns in the variability, and by that, if we have something that looks like this, I'm kind of exaggerating. It's pretty obvious here that as we get larger, we're fanning out. See, the variability vertically is getting bigger. Now, obviously, this could come back in, go back out, or could start big and go small. We're looking for no pattern. A pattern in this would indicate that we do not have a constant variance. And again, that will not affect whether the slope of the regression line is significant. It won't affect a prediction in terms of using the line, but it will tremendously affect any type of prediction interval, trying to do a confidence interval for that prediction. So let's take a moment and work with the finger lakes data, and let's see what happens. I want to determine the appropriateness of the model, which means I'm going to do a scatter plot and go through the whole process. I want to use the model to estimate the number of dead fish if the pollution index were to be, say, 10 and 13.75. So I need to talk about how I would actually use the model. And I want to discuss the value and interpretation of R squared, the coefficient of determination. So that, I think, would be a really good place to break this video off and do one more video, because this one's getting a bit long, and we'll address all of that.